another group of diseases where we should speak about it are certain metabolic diseases. And here I would like to particularly point out to the fact that when we speak about arteriosclerosis, that actually 80% of patients have arteriosclerosis purely because of, you know, bad habits, you know, poor eating habits, poor nutrition, heavy smoking, and too much stress, and so on and so forth. But in 20% of patients, the problems with the metabolism of lipids that leads to arteriosclerosis or atherosclerosis is in reality of genetic nature. Many of such patients, unless they are helped in some other way, will die very young as a result of advancing atherosclerosis. There are young people who die, you know, of heart attack at age of 25 because of genetic atherosclerosis. Now, there is only one way to deal with patients like that. If somebody is found to belong to these, you know, disease entities, where the atherosclerosis can be linked seriously to genetic issues, there the cell transplantation should be strongly considered. And, you know, because it may make a difference between life and death of such a patient. Kidney diseases have been much less treated by cell transplantation for reasons which are not, you know, very clear to me. Much less has been published about such treatment. But, you know, we know very well that, as you already discussed, the situation with diabetic retinopathy, nephropathy, if the patient, for whatever reason, is going to have frequent attacks of nephritis, meaning the inflammatory condition of the kidneys, for a reason which is, you know, not always very apparent, there may be some genetic issues involved. After several attacks of nephritis, this patient will be found to have damage to the kidneys, which is already beyond repair. And if this damage of the kidneys will continue, that this patient will reach this, very soon the stage of kidney failure requiring hemodialysis and/or kidney transplantation. So definitely a patient who has had, you know, 2-3 attacks of nephritis, the inflammatory condition of kidneys, I'm not talking about a pyelonephritis where there is pus in the urine, which is normally a result of the infection, you know, ascending from the bladder into the kidneys. I'm talking about the inflammatory, you know, condition when there are, you know, definitely immunological issues, you know, at stake in majority of instances. Such patients should very strongly consider, you know, cell transplantation before the kidneys truly show evidence of failure. Next is a very interesting subject, which I named multiple years ago in one of my first books, aging disease. Now, why I stated aging disease rather than talking about aging, the natural, you know, natural phenomenon in the body, you see. According to the scientists, we should live 120 years. In reality, as you very well know, very few people do live 120 years. The longest living, nationality seem to be Japanese, that have the average, you know, survival 8 years. It is still only 2/3 of what the scientists are saying. It means that we really are dying, all of us, prematurely, with very, very, very few exceptions of people who do live until 120 years of age. Now, historically, the cell transplantation, cell therapy has become so well known because people have been seeking fountain of youth for all of these years. And it is people of all walks of life, in particularly the rulers of the countries, that actually wanted to, you know, stay in power longer. President of the countries, you know, prime ministers, you know, big artists, and so on and so forth. When we say that in Germany, the official statistics about how many patients have been treated by cell transplantation, we know that between 1950 to 1990, it was 5 million patients. Estimation is that 4 million out of 5 million of Germans that seek cell therapy cell and therapy. In a way, they did so because they tried to slow down the aging. This is a well-known fact. And again, it is really, you know, we are talking about people from, you know, different walks of life, and these cases are very proven. According to the documents of the German Bundesgesundheitsamt, which is the same thing like FDA, there was a gentleman in Germany who had the treatment altogether 33 times every year, you know, from whatever 50 years of life until 83 years of life, and so on and so forth. And his case was followed very closely, all laboratory tests and so on and so forth. It was found that the, you know, cell therapy has caused no harm to his body. There was no immune reactions to the implant itself and so on and so forth. And he actually remained in good condition all this time. People who had, you know, the treatment, not exactly 33 times, but less than that, there have been quite a few in Germany. List of individuals who had the cell therapy quite frequent, you know, royalty and, you know, nobility and big artists and big politicians is actually, you know, quite well known. And, you know, some people kept this secret, some people have not kept this so secret, but the truth of the matter is that it, in reality, works. Know from my own experience that the of doctors, big experts in cell therapy in Germany that I have met in my life and known, most of them live very long, into their 90s, you know. And I don't think it was because necessarily of their best behavior. All right. So in other words, the cell therapy has been useful for this purpose. Unfortunately, this is another matter which the governments ignore, and it seems to be in the hands of private individuals, because governments around the world have only one desire. You reach the retirement age, we have to start to pay you a pension, and that very moment, we would like you to die as soon as possible. Now, this is actually a tremendous loss, because as we know today, where, you know, perhaps the young generation is not as eager to work hard as their parents or grandparents and so on and so forth, many companies are actually, you know, inviting the retired people to come back to work because they are better quality workers than, you know, than the next generation. Even today, probably, the treatment of aging disease is the most common indication for cell transplantation in the world. I would like to point out to the fact that this therapeutic method was largely unknown in Asia until 2006, when I was one of the first people that, you know, began to lecture about the subject. And now Asians are absolutely crazy about cell therapy treatment. Let's talk about treatment of neurodegenerative diseases. I am very proud that during 7 years of my life that I worked in Soviet Union and Russian Federation, I was, you know, one of the leaders of the group of Soviet and Russian neurologists and scientists that developed treatment of incurable neurodegenerative diseases by cell transplantation. Which was not done before. If you go into textbook of neurology, you will find out there is about 250 diagnoses of particularly diseases of so-called white matter, all of them incurable. There's only one of them which can be temporarily treated, and that is a Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease for a while, for 2-3 years, can be successfully treated by L-DOPA. But ultimately, every patient with Parkinson's disease stops responding to L-DOPA and starts to die at that point in time. And the only way to stop this inevitable progression is by giving patient cell transplantation, which in this case is carried out by implantation into the cerebrospinal fluid, or by the procedure that is known in medicine as lumbar puncture. We have had tremendous experience in this area in the Soviet Union, and truly you can do miracles as long as you follow the basic rules. The moment that a diagnosis of such disease is made, the patient immediately has to be treated by cell transplantation, because this, all of these diseases are progressing very fast. Some maybe not so fast, but once the disease is running over a certain border where the patient's life becomes truly miserable, that is usually too late, because unfortunately what the problem is that cell transplantation cannot turn the tide back. In other words, the patient who has already reached a certain advanced stage, you can accomplish only one thing by treatment. You can stop further progression of the disease. You cannot reverse the disease into a completely healthy condition, and so on and so forth. That's why timely treatment and fast treatment is mandatory. Okay. Now, we also proved, you know, later on, particularly in the country of South Africa, these patients were treated in Germany, that the spinal cord injuries can be successfully treated. And we treated patients with old spinal cord injuries, where I myself wouldn't have believed that it is possible to help such patients, particularly when the CT scan clearly showed complete transection of the spinal cord. To my great surprise, you know, you could not bring these people back to normal, but you certainly could help them, and help them, you know, in the additional rehabilitation. So the spinal cord injuries are not a hopeless situation. Unfortunately, this information, despite the fact it was all published, have not gone, you know, much further beyond what I'm telling you, and maybe some people reading the information. But that is a true fact of life, and that should not be ignored. Next, use of cell transplantation in surgery in general. There are many patients when approaching surgery, acute surgery or chronic surgery, which are classified by surgeons poor surgical risks. These are individuals, these are patients who are, you know, in advanced age usually, or they suffer from a variety of medical conditions. And the surgeons, you know, hesitate to operate on them, even if it's necessary, and delay operations because they are afraid of one basic thing, that these people will not heal after surgery. And by delayed healing, they will stay in bed for much longer period of time, and as a result of it, develop the usual complications like embolization, pneumonias, and so on and so forth, which are, of course, very frequently cause of death. And so I would like to, you know, inform the surgeons that if every patient that is classified as poor surgical risk would 1 to 2 weeks after surgery receive cell transplantation, the issue of poor healing would be non-existent. Right? Now, in terms of reality, these facts are mostly proven by orthopedic surgeons, and there are publications, you know, dealing with the matter, where every time there is an issue of poor healing, you know, a matter, these patients indeed should receive a cell transplantation, because the bone is one of the, you know, least well healing tissue in human body, okay? And this kind of problems could be resolved. Now, this is very much applicable to $1 million worth professional athletes who have to, you know, finish their professional career because of injuries of sometimes ridiculously, you know, unimportant bones in a normal life, and so on and so forth, and that, you know, which is a result of the non-healing fracture of that small bone in the foot, or sometimes in the wrist, and so on and so forth, have to finish. And the insurance companies have to pay millions of dollars in compensation to the to the clubs and to the athletes and so on and so forth. Now, nobody has ever done this, but I wish that it would be that some of these patients would be referred for cell transplantation, because all of this could be turned into a positive outcome. Next, let's talk about the genetic diseases. You know, all genetic and chromosomal diseases are written out in a textbook of pediatrics or whatever other textbooks under the chapter of treatment by one or two sentences. There is no known treatment, because in reality there are no known treatment of genetic diseases. There are few, you know, very few, where a certain prophylaxis whereby the child does not take, you know, certain food, etc., etc., that the development of symptoms can be delayed or stopped and so on and so forth. But in majority of instances, you know, the genetic disease in reality means a guaranteed death. It took a long time before this broke through, but it was actually a German pediatrician, you know, Franz Schmidt, who proved to the world that the very common chromosomal disease called Down syndrome or Manga disease actually is a treatable disease. And because it is a common disease, and because his work was followed very closely in Germany, that he was a very, very well-known pediatrician, Jimmy Dolan was running certain statistics. And according to statistics of the West German government, in reality, children with Down syndrome who were treated in a timely manner by cell transplantation were able to pass entrance exams into German state kindergartens. Germany is a country where the state schools were of much better quality than private schools at all times, you know. So to make an entrance exam into kindergarten, it was a big deal, because Down syndrome child under no circumstances could pass such an entrance exam. But Down syndrome child treated by cell therapy was able to do that in 50% of instances. Now, the child, you know, that actually got into kindergarten was usually in one half of instances able to enter elementary school and even high school and finish vocational school, be able to get a job and become independent of the family and the society. Now, this, of course, should be of interest to everybody, you know, governments likewise, because it saves a lot of money and turns unproductive individual into productive individual. Right? Now, various countries in the world, you know, in reality, only country of Australia has actually allowed this experience to be reproduced, and Australians likewise found out that this to be the case. When a child is born with genetic disease, okay, the name of the game is start with cell transplantation as soon as possible. Now, it doesn't mean that it will be successful in every case, but the sooner you do the first treatment, the faster you will see if this possibility is existent, okay? There are children that are born, you know, with genetic diseases so destructive that, you know, that you sometimes just by observation of the child, you can see, you know, this if this child is going to respond to this treatment, it will be a miracle. Sometimes those miracles do happen. But the name of the game is you have to act fast, because human being is peculiar in one part of the body, and that is the central nervous system. A human being is born, when it comes to central nervous system, in unfinished condition. The entire first year of life, the brain is so underdeveloped that the human being is unable to, of independent survival of nature. In other words, the Tarzan could not survive under the care of gorilla if he would have been less than 12 months old. Because human being in the first 12 months of life is called extrauterine embryo. Okay. In other words, all the other animals, as you know, they are born and immediately are standing up their feet. they are moving, they are able to, you know, feed themselves, you know, sucking on the mother and so on and so forth. Human being is actually not able, you know, to this type of independent existence. Okay, now the name of the game is, in all of these patients, that kind of patients, you must definitely take an action during the first 4 years of life. After 4 years, the door is closed. You cannot really accomplish much, but during the first 4 years, you can accomplish a lot. In particular, when you start the therapy in the first, you know, year of life. In our case, we recommend additional treatments after the first one, only with full cooperation of parents, because we like to see the patient, that the parents themselves can see the level of progress they can observe in their own child. So this has been a tremendous breakthrough, which was mostly stimulated by Professor Dr. Franz Schmid. Okay. Subgroup of this group of patients are patients with mental retardation of unknown etiology. In many cases, you know, it is not possible to determine whether the mental retardation is indeed of genetic nature. But if there is any indication that there is, you know, the development of the intellect of the patient is slowed down, the treatment by cell transplantation should be tried. The same rule applies. The treatment should be carried out within the first 4 years of life. Let's talk about some other of these pediatric problems. And one of them is very common condition called cerebral palsy. Cerebral palsy is, again, not a disease, it's a label. The brain damage in patients labeled with cerebral palsy is due to a variety of conditions. And all of these children with cerebral palsy can be treated by cell transplantation successfully, but the treatment must be started in the first 4 years of life. Regretfully, we see this all the time, that 90% of requests to treat patients with cerebral palsy is past the age of 4, when we have to turn down the patient because they passed their prime, so to speak. Okay. Now, there are some types of the cerebral palsy where the treatment can be done even after the first 4 years of life, but that is already, you know, done on a case-by-case basis. A lot of these children with genetic and chromosomal diseases suffer from diseases which are very, very rare. And, you know, and there's about 4,500 different genetic syndromes described and, you know, are listed in the textbooks of genetics. Because of the rarity, it is impossible, even when you are working in the field of cell transplantation, to know if this particular child suffering from a rare genetic disease can actually be treated successfully by cell transplantation. The truth of the matter is that cell transplantation is an extremely safe treatment. Safe treatment means that you practically can guarantee the parent, explain to the parents, that because the condition that the child is suffering from is extremely rare and is not really actual patient like that, is not described anywhere in medical literature, or, you know, is not part of our professional experience, we simply don't have any other choice but to use the same patient as being the clinical trial subject, because we have to, only by observation of the patient himself or herself, you know, we can actually determine, you know, whether there is possibility to improve the condition of this child by cell transplantation or not. All right, and we simply do not have any other option here. Okay. There is another disease here now becoming extremely common in the civilized world, which is called autism. Today, autism is perhaps the, you know, most common, you know, serious disease, you know, known to parents and the society in the world. Autism was described originally in 1943 by Austrian physician Kanner. And his description is extremely clear-cut. Unfortunately, today somebody decided to confuse the whole issue by creating so-called new classification consisting of the called autism spectrum disorders, which besides classical autism contains seven other diseases which allegedly are similar as autism, which of course is complete nonsense because at least two of them, attention deficit disorder and hyperactive child syndrome, are not even diseases. They are being given very serious psychiatric drugs, but that is truly a very, very, bad medicine. And so we absolutely will not treat any child with attention deficit disorder or the hyperactive children. Remaining five, different diseases from the so-called autism spectrum disorder classification, we do not have enough experience, in terms of treatment by cell transplantation, so we generally would refuse to treat such patients unless we really have a very big expert in autism explaining us exactly what is going on in the brain of such patient, in which case we may decide to treat such patient. Okay, now, as long as we treat patients with classical autism, the results have been truly extraordinarily good. The problem is that sometimes these patients are brought to us very late, at age of 12 or past, at which time there is a problem, because by the age of 12, the so-called blood-brain barrier or hematoencephalic barrier in the brain of a patient has been closed down. As a result, we cannot do implantation by the usual way when we implant the cells subcutaneously under the skin of the patient. And we must do the implantation into the cerebrospinal fluid, meaning by lumbar puncture. Now, to do lumbar puncture in a child with autism, who is, let's say 12 years old or 13 years old, etc., is not so easy because they very frequently will not cooperate. Cell transplantation cannot under any circumstances be done under general anesthesia, because all the toxic drugs which are given to the patient during general anesthesia would certainly kill the implanted cells. So the treatment would be all for nothing. But as long as we treat such patients past the age of 12 by cell transplantation done via lumbar puncture intrathecally, then the results have been surprisingly good. 1996, I created a therapeutic concept of treatment of the incurable untreatable diseases, or chronic diseases in general, which I call a pyramid of life, where the therapeutic approaches are basically on a five different levels. Level one is one which does not really require a medical doctor, because we are talking here about a diet and nutrition, which should be handled by a nutritionist and by the chef that will teach people about proper eating and proper preparation of food. Number two is active exercise, where we need a a trainer that is actually not only going to explain to people how to exercise and teach them how to exercise. Next is the stress handling, which should be handled preferably by a qualified psychologist that is going to teach people in various techniques of how to deal with stress and meditation, training in self-hypnosis, etc., etc. And ultimate next point is the dealing with issues of spiritual immersion, which usually requires a participation of a respective clergyman. And last item is the lifestyle modifications. In other words, if patient is not prepared, everything that the patient is to undertake by being willing to learn about how to eat properly, how to exercise, how to deal with the stress, it is my professional opinion that patients should not waste time, you know, and money on doctors, you know, and on all of these other steps that I will be speaking about, because the result of these medical steps will be substantially diminished as compared with what would be possible. On level two, we are talking about besides already the training in proper exercise, we are talking about physiotherapy, various forms of oxygen therapy, various forms of homeopathy, and other forms of detoxification. On level three, we are talking about chelation therapy. We are talking about the enzymotherapy and microbial therapy. Level four is the electromagnetic therapies or electric therapies that I already mentioned earlier. And the level five is the cell transplantation. That is the order in which things should be basically done. So you are actually using the electric therapy and the cell transplantation only to patients that have been already prepared for it, because then you indeed will get the best results. Now, this is, in my opinion, a very important matter. Unfortunately, in real life, it is sometimes very difficult to accomplish, because, you know, sometimes you don't have time to procrastinate. As I already mentioned, you know, time is of the essence in some of the patients with serious, incurable, untreatable diseases. But if you can, you should do things in an orderly manner. That is extremely important. In other words, one should do things right. But the bottom line is, when we talk about treatment of incurable and untreatable diseases, in the end, without cell transplantation, you cannot say that you have done your job all the way as a physician. And to tell about at the same time to tell the patient, "Oh, terribly sorry, you know, your condition is simply incurable and untreatable, and there is nothing we can do for you," that is unprofessional and not serious in front of the human being that is your patient.